to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The first order of business is recognition of business.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm glad that the government knows.
Do you want me to go ahead and read it? Resolution 2013-02, a resolution of the City Commission of the City of Apalachicola, Florida, proclaiming April 21st through the 27th, 2013, National Volunteer Week, whereas the entire community can inspire, equip, and mobilize people to take action that changes the world, and whereas individuals and communities are the center of social change, discovering their power to make a difference. And whereas during the week of April 21st through 27th, 2013, all over the nation, service projects will be performed and volunteers organized for their commitment to service. And whereas the giving of oneself to service, in service to another, empowers the giver and the recipient. And whereas our country's volunteer force of over 63 million is a great treasure. And whereas volunteers are vital to our future as a caring and productive nation, and now therefore be it resolved by the City Commission of the City of Apalachicola, to do hereby proclaim April 21st through 27th, 2013, National Volunteer Week in the City of Apalachicola, and also urge our fellow citizens to volunteer in Franklin County and the City of Apalachicola by volunteering and recognizing those who serve by tirelessly sharing their time and talent with those in need. Adopted this second day of April, 2013.
What's the pleasure of the board?
So moved.
I have a motion by Commissioner Barker. Do I have a second?
Second.
By Commissioner Cook, there is any discussion? If there is no discussion, I have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by aye.
Aye.
All opposed, motion carries.
Thank you all very much. We appreciate that.
Jim, back there. Permission to hold fireworks.
Mr. Mayor, the commission is asking for 2 minutes. I'm here to ask permission to allow the YOLA, Historic Main Street Program, partnering with the City of Apalachicola, to host a second annual July 3rd Independence Day celebration. Just real quickly, what that would entail is, of course, our traditional red, white, and blue parade, which this year I think is going to grow to quite a large size. It runs from Lafayette Park down to Riverfront Park. That'll be followed by an ice cream social. Then we'll have throughout the evening a kids' corner at the park. All kinds of activities for kids throughout the night, face painting, being better, all that good stuff. We have a great band lined up who will be performing on the Lady Louise, which is our shrimp boat park down at the park, as we did last year. And we've got a special attraction this year, too. The Hillside Community Choir is going to be performing. And if you haven't heard of it, they're fabulous. And of course, the fireworks. And we've been able to double up the amount of fireworks this year over what we did last year, with some real surprises, which we're not going to talk about. I wanted to mention, as I said, I'm here to get permission from the city. As we did last year, there will be VIP seating. We'll be set up the mayor and all the city commissioners. And in no way do I want that to influence your decision. All of this is free, with the exception we'll have food and beverages, but it will be at a very, very minimal cost. So basically, everything's going to be fine. In my formerly maintained hands, I have a liability policy that the city named for $4 million for the event. I have the Department of Homeland Security's permit carry on an aerial show, which is, has to be done. Also, the U.S. Coast Guard's permit to use the waterways at the time, at that time. And our custom-designed pyro shows double up from last year. I'm done.
What's the measure of the
board? Well, I'd like to compliment Charles Fireworks from last year.
Thank you.
Back.
Me too. That's excellent.
That was the best I've been saying in the end of the year.
You know what's really neat about this is the community, the way it was formed. I mean, already people are coming to us saying, when can we get it? Let's get this going. Ready to start. Really.
Have a motion by Commissioner Elliott, second by Commissioner Bartley. Are there any discussions? If there's no discussion, have a motion and second. All in favor, signify by aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carried.
Thank you.
Bobby.
Here to help you hold that camera.
Bobby Pettis.
You want to run it?
Good evening. It's a pleasure to be for you tonight.
I love you.
We wanted to highlight a program that progress energy is going to be offering in the next few weeks here in the city of Apalachicola to assist low-income households with the adoption of energy efficiency measures and things that are going to the program's administrator, Dr. Development, Phil Potts, and he's going to come up and actually do the presentation to me if that's okay.
Yes.
First of all, I'd like to say good evening, Mr. Mayor, Commissioners, Apalachicola residents. It is certainly a pleasure to be among you tonight. Before I get started in my presentation, I have to always take the opportunity to introduce my partner, Mr. Vernon McQueen. Vernon and I had the pleasure of going all over the state of Florida and Progress Energy Service Territory to implement the program that we are about to bring to the Apalachicola community. It's called the Neighborhood Energy Saver Program, and if you follow along with me on the slides there, I'll guide you through it there. Our goals and objectives are pretty clear. What we endeavor to do is be able to assist families in low-income neighborhoods by installing 16 free energy conservation items. We also look to educate these families on proper energy efficiency techniques, best practices. That's extremely important because most of what we learn about how to use energy, we usually learn from one another. Needless to say, if you're not a practitioner, most of what you know probably may be wrong. So we are trying to make sure that we're sharing good information with the residents that we're touching base with. We also endeavor to change the way that they think about how to use power. There is a lot of myths associated with how to use electricity. And again, we like to make sure that we are telling them right through this program we pick that opportunity. And last but not least, helping them understand that they actually control what they use in the house, barring the state of the housing stock and that kind of thing. Eligibility is real easy. We use the same guidelines that's used in Tallahassee, also in Washington, D.C., which is basically 200% of the poverty income guideline. Of course, they have to be poverty energy customers, and they have to reside in the census data block. Now, on the next slide, you will see a page that looks like this. This is a refined version of the census. And what we actually did was partner with the University of Florida to be able to help us identify every person that met our criteria, and they drew up a series of census plots for us. Now what you will see in the census plot, or in the writing below, where we are actually going to be doing our outreach. It basically starts here at the beginning of town there at Market Street and 98. Go all the way down to Pell River Road / Airport Road, up to Bluff Road, back into 12th Street, over into all that area over there, and then basically we come right back out Market Street. So we're talking about 1,179 customers, and we already know that that number will grow, and that's fine. We have no problem with that. We will start our pursuit of the neighborhood next Wednesday, 10th. are scheduled to go through July the 12th. For however long it takes us to be able to do our work in the community, we'll be here to do it. We employ an implementation strategy, which brings us right here where we are right now. And we'll talk a little bit about that, our connection with key leaders in the community, also how we get the word out about some of the items that we'll actually install in the home, and then we'll circle back to the whole idea of how to save energy. So key leaders for us, anyone from City Hall all the way up to the United States Congress, because at some point or another, Vernon and I have actually encountered all of those folks in some way, shape, form, or fashion. We also like to come into the community and reach out to as many community leaders as we can identify. Apalachicola has certainly been one of those organizations that we look to partner with. On our notification campaign, what you saw come in the mail last week, probably about Friday, the packet of information with the, a letter from our Senior Vice President, Mr. Michael Lewis, an invitation to a kickoff event next Tuesday night at the Senior Center there from 7 to 9 p.m. And you're all invited. Whether or not you got a packet of this information, please come back. And an authorization form, because we do have to have permission to be able to come to a resident's home. Now, one thing that I would like to point out to you is that on the invitation, we actually did something that we have not been doing. We asked people to RSVP their attendance so that we can get a good head count of how many people that we actually think would show up, so we make sure we got enough food. Well, for those of you who got it, the 800 number is wrong. It's actually an 866 number. Of course, that lets you know that at my advantage, I do need to have glasses on every time that I've got a food site. But tomorrow, my team will be on the ground, and they will be distributing a letter just like this that actually lets the residents know the correct phone, even if they don't RSVP. We still want them to come so they can get a chance to see what it is that we are going to be doing in their homes. We will share whatever we have by way of food until it's all gone. So certainly please come out. Now, also coming in the mail is a postcard reminder. And what we'll have on it is the date that we will be in the home, as well as the time. The time for us is either a.m. or p.m. a.m. is between 9 and noon. p.m. is between 1 and 5 in the evening. Now, we had to do something a little bit accelerated here with our notification campaign, because as Bobby knows, we are in the midst of an identification change, Joe. So we're about to change over all of our logos and everything. So we had to accelerate our process so we didn't find that back out here. Now, what we call the ground game contains a media announcement, and our communications group has already sent out correspondence to that effect to the print media as well as the broadcast media. And then the kickoff event, which we're talking about Tuesday night, then I will show you the actual production process. Now, also going in the mail on Friday will be a postcard reminder. It's just a copy of the invitation, but thank God it don't have the wrong email number on it. But just a reminder of what we're going to be doing on Tuesday night. Now, when we have what we call our kickoff events, we have these everywhere. In the 34 or so communities that Vernon and I have been in, we do these everywhere from community centers, the churches, wherever is comfortable and convenient for the community. The kickoff event looks something very much like this. What we actually have is a half-hour party. I was about to say party, but a half-hour get-together. And we have a little scripted program where we basically share what it is that we're going to be doing. We'll also ask folks such as yourself, Your Honor, to come up and just say a few words about your impression of the program. And then we get down to the real thing. We get down to the eat. night before our team is scheduled to arrive in your neighborhood or on your block, they will actually come and leave a door hanger. It looks just like this. And the door hanger simply states that we will be at your home on the next day. Now, the truck that our team will be coming through the community in looks just like this. They have a satellite vehicle, but for the most part, this is what can be asked them to put in a very visible location. And it serves a dual purpose. Not only does it serve to identify our program, but we also use it as a security feature too, because one of the things that we tell our residents, this is not that truck, it's not us. Because from time to time, we have had folks that actually piggyback off of us in the community. Now, first thing that our team is going to do when they come to the home, and you see the green shirt. The green shirt is also very purposeful in what we do. That's a security feature as well. We want them to be seen when they're crossing the street. Not only that, but we like to make sure that people understand that this is what they wear when they come to your house. Not only that, but they do wear identification on their shirt so that you'll know that they are legitimate. So after our guy gets to explain what it is that we are going to be doing in the home, then they'll start going through the home to look at items that we can install. Like I said, we install up to 16 free energy conservation measures. Every home will not take 16 measures, but whatever we can put in the house, we'll do it. So we do things like air infiltration reduction. So what that basically means is that we look for penetrations that come into the home, normally under the sink or by way of the air conditioning unit. That needs sealed because air does go in and out that way. So we actually do form parking that cuts off that area. We do weather stripping. We don't do the peel and stick variety. We actually have metal weather stripping with rubber sides on it that they actually screw into the door frame. And we do two doors per home on that. Our hot water improvements, one of the things that we do as well is we check the temperature of the water. Because if the temperature is over 125 degrees, it needs to be turned down. We can't turn it down, but we will inform you so that you can have your husband, your son, or someone like that turn it down. We also install up to 3 water flow restrictors, one in the kitchen that has a swivel attachment to it, and then 2 fixed, one in each bathroom if you have 12 bathrooms. We also install 2 low flow shower heads. If you're a senior with a disability, we will install a hose attachment for our shower heads. We wrap the water heater. And we also wrap the hot and cold water pipes as well. We clean refrigerator faucets. Another one of those silencing things, and a refrigerator is actually a pretty significant portion of your actual electric bill. So our guy actually gets down and he cleans the refrigerator coils, and then he gives you the brush. So every 3 or 4 months, you can also get your husband, your kids, your grandkids, to do the clean up those refrigerator coils. We as well put a refrigerator monitor in the fresh food section as well as the freezer so that we can gear you toward just getting the refrigerator to medium temperatures. We also install a wall plate monitor on the far wall away from the air conditioner, and the whole idea is for you to be able to look at that temperature and be able to see if it's more than 3 or 4 degrees. If it's more than 3 or 4 degrees from what you actually have the air conditioner set on, then you need to call an air conditioning man so that he can come and make sure that the unit is functioning properly. We install up to 5 compact fluorescent light bulbs, 123-watt light bulb that actually duplicates a 100-watt incandescent bulb, 218 watts that would be the equivalent of 75 watts, 213 watts, which would be the equivalent of 60-watt light bulb. On our air conditioning improvements, you have central air and heat. We will give you a year's supply of filters. It usually takes our guys about 3 weeks to a month because we are a pretty huge order of filters. So 12 filters for central air and heating units. If you have all units, then we will give you 2 washable filters that should last. We also give you a filter calendar. This will magically you can put on the refrigerator. It's about a year. So you can circle the date that you change the filter, and the next month you can change it at the same time. And if you have window unit air conditioner, we will give you a cover for the unit that services the main portion of the house. Other things that we do, we talk around windows, air conditioners, and doors. You can't replace windows, but they're broken and our guys can attach money. And last but not least, we you with what we call a leave behind or a sheet that looks just like this. And what our guy will do is to check out each item that we install in the home, and we'll emphasize the savings from the measures that we install. But again, the real education piece here is not so much the stuff that we're going to leave behind, as much as what you need to do to be able to save yourself some money in the future. The majority of the units that we will install, or I should say measures, will actually save you up to $150 a year. Nice wood savings, but again, you can enhance that by practicing those energy efficiency techniques and best practices that we spoke about. Can I answer any questions?
This program did just start because I know a lady here a few months back that her hot water heater went out, and I saw her yard distraught, and I stopped and asked what was wrong, you know. She told me the heater was out, she had kids, so I went and got her a new hot water heater. The next day she came back and told me, y'all put one in her house out, she didn't need it.
Well, you know, we want to make sure that we are, I guess I can say is getting clear on what we do, so we make sure we're not bagging the water heaters in Apalachicola. We can't replace it, but we will have it. Again, one of the folks that we have invited to the kickoff event on Tuesday night is a gentleman named Mr. Tim Centers. Many of you may know Tim. Tim is actually from Capital Area Community Action Agency in Tallahassee. They actually have jurisdiction over this area for the state's weatherization program. And Tim will be a great guy to engage, to make sure that we can get an application in queue so that we may have some dollars that didn't actually take care of those types of items.
We have that program here, right, Joe?
Yes, you do.
Joe, we do have that program.
Yeah, we deal with it every day.
So again, we will start on Wednesday the 10th with actual taxing, and we will go through July 12th and beyond. So again, please come out to the kickoff event on Tuesday night. We would love to see you. Thank you.
Thank you. You sure?
Two old applicant we had back when we had the previous executive director. We have not received any new recommendations at this time, so we need to table that until the next meeting.
Okay. Planning and zoning report. Do we have a copy of the P&D report?
Actually, they did not approve minutes at the last meeting. They will approve February and March meetings next week, so there were no minutes to confirm tonight.
Okay.
There's really, Robin, Jeff, you're on the board. Is there anything particular that we think we need to bring forward?
Not this time to the commission after next week.
If I have a question on zoning, do I do it later?
There you are.
Okay. First of all, let me apologize to you. I have lots of paperwork for you tonight. I know you love paperwork. First of all, I just want to mention that the planning zoning board, as you know, with the fire inspection program that we have discussed a couple of times, you've asked them to take it to the planning zoning board to see if they want to include that as part of their requirement, as part of their process. They have chosen not to do that. The other part of the program was brought forth by Ashley T, as you all know, to talk about the requirement for the, or the need and the requirement through the Florida statutes for an inspector to do fire inspection throughout the city, county, municipalities, that type of thing. And I have printed out the actual Florida statutes. It's very lengthy. I have not had time to review it. I have talked to Ashley individually a little bit. So I'm not prepared at this time to give any kind of recommendation of how we move forward. I do understand the city of Carroll has said that they are willing to work toward that as well, but I have not received any official word from that. I just heard that. I don't know whether Ashley wants to add anything at this time, but I am willing to work with Ashley and see if we can come with a recommendation of something we think might be able to work at your time, unless you have any questions or Ashley wants to add to that.
The safer grant, that's where Homeland Security had fire department funded, so they had sent it out in September. That's when we went back to paper this. Also, there's several ways to do this. They call out the ISO rating. The new 213 religious fire inspectors will be part of our process. Will help us get a bit of a better ISO rating. Right now, it's not. So, until July 1st, the ISO rating will be adopted throughout all the United States. And so when the state board adopts that, when they do our next ISO rating, the fire inspectors will be part of the process. We need to wait and start. We don't need to wait because too late to get. So we got a program. We start a program. We got to have this program in place. And I think it'll be a benefit for the citizens, the community, and our business. You know, I talked to several businesses. I've got a list of about 90 people going around. The 90 people around I talked with, that it's a no-brainer. We can keep our insurance right now, the way it is. We win. It's about to get lower because the insurance prices right now, they threaten to raise everything. The insurance with sinkholes. How many sinkholes have in front of the county? I ain't seen one, so the insurance rates been raised up. There's hurricanes, they speculate. That's why we need to stay on our fire, so make sure our businesses are safe. Make sure everybody's in the meat and clean. I call the Interstate Fire Company. When they come in with the sprinkler system, the fire alarm system, the hood system, yeah, they expect. So as a local authority, it's our responsibility to make sure these businesses are working. They keep them up code, they stay in code. The main thing, when we do a fire inspection, is safety of our firefighters. 2 o'clock in the morning or whenever we go to a building, we need to know what's in that building. Today, we all volunteer. I choose to volunteer. I love it. I started here when I was 18 years old. I've been there since I've been there. I'm thankful for what the city has given me an opportunity to do. Part of this fire department. So, I want to see our fire department hands. Come up with some things. Be a better fire department. I appreciate y'all's time and effort within this and looking forward to making the city be a safe place.
Okay, like I said, I'm not sure at this point how the city falls in with the Florida statute that I've printed, but I'm going to review it, try to have some ideas, talk to Ashley and see if I can move forward. But as I said before, my first inclination is that I think something we need to do through our fire department, and that's something I've
said. Also, you call the chief is in favor.
Where's the chief? We need to start there. It's a small amount there. And if we do move in that direction. Just to let you know, I'm going to continue working on that. Before I get into this, we can say, I have ran across a grant through FWC that would allow us to do some renovation of the battery park arena. That would be to complete the seawall that's on the south side of the base that's never completed, and to do the dredging that Commissioner Elliott has been wanting to try to do. Actually, it's a grant for transient recreational vessels 26 feet or more. So I think it's a good opportunity for us to at least explore that. What I need from you at this point is authorization to go ahead and submit the application and authorize the mayor or myself to sign documents required for that application.
So moved. I make motion to accept that.
Second. Motion by Commissioner Parker. Second by Commissioner Cook. Are there any discussion? If there's no discussion, I have a motion to second. All the basics are by aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carried.
Yes, on the side of the basin. Yes. Okay, what this is, I'm very pleased to say that Wilbur has completed the first section of the code enforcement training. He has taken the state test. We're waiting for the results, but And he feels pretty confident that he did pretty well on that. The first thing that they did tell him that now they have the code enforcement regulations that you follow in the Florida statute. This is statute 162. They recommend the first thing we do to get our program going is to adopt these statutes. I don't expect you to do anything tonight, but I'd like you to review it and be prepared for the next meeting to possibly go ahead and adopt this. It does not do away with the nuisance ordinance. It will that will stay in place. So we have any element of that that we need to follow under any other issue that may arise, that will still be in place. It's not to replace that. The Florida statute does supersede any segment of that that isn't in conflict with it. Okay? So nothing to say for time. Everything else I have for you is, you can just take some pass them out. What this is the Planning and Zoning Board has been addressing several issues. Number one is the new flood regulations. Number two is the new future land use map. And number three is the coastal, high hazard coastal area. The future land use map and the high hazard coastal map, those two are actually comp plan changes that were required for Rebecca to talk into the request up sheets here. So we need to have a joint workshop with you guys. We're trying to schedule that. Okay. Well, the first ones I gave you are actually the flood-related documents. The second ones here are the other two, the future land use map and also the high hazard maps. We were trying to schedule the workshop at the same time. Planning and Zoning meets next Monday night at 6 o'clock, if you can plan on being there for that. It is the PMZ's regular meeting. They will open their meeting, do some items of business, and then you'll go into the joint workshop. This is the first joint workshop. There could possibly be another one. Planning and Zoning has every option to hold the workshops that they choose that they need for these adoptions of these documents. Also, in addition to that, there is a very lengthy ordinance that will have to be adopted under the new flood ordinance that's required under the new regulations. I'm going to go ahead and give a copy to the city attorney for any reviews at this time. I don't think I'll bother you with a copy of it at this point unless you want a copy, but I think in the future you'll definitely need one. We're just trying to get
what you said. What you said the purpose was?
This is for the new flood regulations. That's under the new flood map. That's what you have a copy of the new map right here.
Well, prepared for the point of clarification, I was stopped by the General Lisa. I was stopped by the General with the very, very question that, and I guess we need to clarify.
Okay. I'll try.
My name is Gary Sala. I work for Robinson Real Estate, here in town. And we've sold the property down on Commerce. I have a contract on the property on next to Harry Arnold's. It's a small lot, 30 by 80. And basically, the C1, your C1 zoning says you can do transient on top, commercial bottom. That's basically what Apalachicola has become. Well, according to what stuff I'm hearing on this new item, you're not going to be able to have commercial on the bottom floor if you build something. I don't know if you've heard that. I was over at the county the other day. Because of the levels and where you have to be above the flood. So that was a question I had, because there's some confusion.
Under our zoning regulations, if you're allowed to have residential, as long as you meet that flood elevation, I don't see any reason why you could not do residential. Have any of you guys?
Commercial.
Commercial.
New construction under new FEMA, this is from the workshop the county held, it's on Commerce. That's all going to be V-zone, and I don't think you'll be able to put commercial on the ground floor.
It's watershed, too.
Commercial on the ground floor?
And the city
or any
zoning and C1 says you can.
This is the conflict we have.
See, I understood as long as you meet the elevation,
you have to raise the building. You have to raise the building this high off the ground.
Right.
Nothing else is like that down there. Everything is like on the ground. I mean, you got this. That's why it's new.
That's what has
to happen.
What does it look like if somebody's got a building 5 feet up and commercial and then another?
So we're going to repeat that there.
We are not going to have any choice in that. That is a federal regulation for the big FEMA maps. It is not a local issue for the city. Our code says you have to be 1 foot above the base flood elevation, which is determined by the FEMA organization.
And so when did they decide the new flood zone when an area is not flooded before?
I can't answer that question.
We have to adopt it?
That gave you has information that you
So we have to adopt a federal flood zone when they've not been down here to see that my house has been here for 50 years and never flooded, and all of a sudden my zone has changed?
Always adopted
You see what I'm saying? Do we have to accept this as our flood zone?
Well, the city has to accept it. I can tell you that you have a right to appeal it. And that, okay. So you certainly have a right as an individual to appeal that.
Okay, next question. If I bought a property that I had approval to build on before all of this came about, shouldn't I be grandfathered in and still build?
As long as you start construction before the new rule goes into effect.
And when does the new rule go into effect?
No.
At this time, it was in early 2014.
Well, you know, we've got the properties in there, which are trying to get another, as you say, we might not get variance. We got a variance to do.
Okay.
Renovation on it, but now they're saying he's got to go
and
6 feet
also,
up.
He can't renovate more than half the value of his own building. He paid cash for this lot, $95,000. He wants to renovate it and make it really nice. It's the old Maxwell Tire. And I guess the rule says he can only spend half the value of the 10 buildings, which is $7,500.
Have you heard that?
That is actually imposed by the county as part of their building code regulation.
But does that apply to what's going on in the city?
Yes, that's current. That's current.
But it's the old Maxwell building. He can't spend more than $7,500. He paid $95,000 cash. I sold it to him. He wanted to fix it up and make it nice. We got a variance to make it transient, kind of what's down that area. And now they're saying he can't spend more than half.
Even though there's houses on the ground right next door to him, all the way down the street.
Well, they're saying basically it's in a flood zone area. You can only spend 50% of the value. And it has been determined to be in a flood zone.
So what we're saying is that if you spend anything more than that, it won't be covered by flood insurance.
Right. He doesn't,
he doesn't care about that. He
paid
cash.
He's not even going to have for that. Because that place...
That's your option.
I mean, I've only been here since 98, but I don't know if the water's open up.
You don't need it till you need it.
But the thing is, I mean, here's a man, he bought his... I mean, this is what I have a problem with. He bought his own property, and people are telling him he can't fix it the way he wants. And that just doesn't seem right.
That's the way it goes.
Well, that doesn't seem right.
I mean, that's the federal. Wait a minute. Close your eyes and picture yourself here. You bought that property, and you were told you could fix it all, and all of a sudden you go back to get your permits, and you can't. Now, how are you going to feel? What are you going to do? Especially when you got approval for your building plans.
We got approval for the building plans.
I would like to say, guys, at this point, I don't think it'd be wise, and I'll ask attorney's opinion on this, but I don't think it'd be wise for us to get a lengthy discussion on this. This is on the Board of Adjustment agenda for an upcoming meeting.
Well, I know Carrie just raised
It's on April the 29th, and this is going to be discussed at that meeting, so I don't want to put the bar in front of the board, I guess the old expression goes.
I don't know
if the attorney...
No, I'm going to take her advice and not say anything.
I just want to go ahead and talk. I don't think it's... I'm going to move to the set.
It's going to be the very process.
It's going to hurt the city as far as development. That's my opinion. That's a real opinion.
That's correct, and I've been... following this close up, and I've talked to officials, Rachel Ward down there, and the issue is, I don't know if he's got a permit or not, but if you've not been permitted yet, it's my understanding that Franklin County participates in a FEMA flood program that gives people here discounts. All of us that are paying flood insurance now are getting that discount. And what I understand from speaking to Rachel Ward is that if we permit something that doesn't conform with the FEMA flood zones, that we jeopardize that program in the whole county, and that they will, and they have before, sent auditors in here to see whether we've conformed or not. That's happened in the past.
I understand that.
So that's the issue. It's kind of not in the city's, it's not the city's decision alone, is what I'm saying.
Right, but it's kind of hurt the city.
Definitely. That's
because I got an email yesterday, this last part, that the FEMA is going to go up already. The government says 25% to start, and they're going to go up even more because they can't afford it.
I have a few extra copies of the map and the information. Yeah,
thanks for coming.
Like
Jeff and I were just talking about a joint workshop.
It'll be wise if I have Cindy and Chris Clark participate in that. they both been very involved in this process, and they'll be able to answer the question a little bit better than I did more personally than I am. I'm still in the learning curve. I don't know something about it yet. But it's not a fund injury. It's going to affect your construction and your citizens, so it's not going to be a fund injury. But we need to have two workshops on that. So I don't need any action on any of that tonight. Conversation continues, absolutely. That's all I have, but you have any questions?
Any questions?
Oh, no, I'm sorry. I do have more. I'm sorry. They remind me. The city attorney would like to thank. Yes, you want to thank him.
From the FEMA, from the storm, and we actually are in design phase now. We were planning on holding off doing any construction until after the July 4th event. We're hoping through the months of May and June we'll finish up design, advertise for the contract, if we're ready to go after the July event.
Who has the engineering design?
It's Preble Rich.
I was just going to ask Attorney Floyd if he would give us an update on the status of our membership in the consortium, where that's going, if they're going to meet this week. And I just, before I go there, I wondered what our status is as city membership.
Okay. Yeah, we submitted the in accordance with 3.01 of the interlocal agreement. The city of Apalachicola submitted simultaneous with the city of Caroline, a request to, actually a resolution joining the consortium and adopted the interlocal agreement that was required for that. That's what 3.01, I think section C requires. So that was done. And then set off, and we received a letter back from the mayor received a letter back from the attorney that represents them. The mayor sent a letter back to them, responding to it the next day. Essentially, the letter said, you don't have a right to join the consortium. And so the letter we sent back says, basically, yes, we do have it. You have, in accordance with the interlocal agreement, some provisions that you can, and conditions that you can assert in connection with that application for membership. But the question we really had was, why in the world would you try to keep the city or any cities that are a major part of the area that is impacted by this, to try to keep them out of anything? They've not been referenced in the act. They've not been referenced in the consortium. They've not been referenced in the committee actually set up. And so that's one of the reasons that the cities had submitted that. So the letter that was sent was questioning why there would even be any hesitation for including the cities on the same authority and on the same basis as set forth in the actual interlocal act, which governs, basically says that there's a proportionate share of responsibility that each bears to that, and which means the cities would be very small.
So we're not going to have anybody there this Friday at that meeting?
Yes, we have a representative, and we tend to be there.
Who's that going to be? Because I'm going to be there taping.
I'm sorry?
Who is that representative going to be? I'm going to be there taping.
The
That's why.
The mayor has asked me to go in at the first meeting. He is the designated representative, but he's asked me to go in his place this time.
And I sat on the Franklin Restore Council meeting that was earlier last week. It's my understanding from what was reported there that the city has not prevailed in their legal action with the county, that their case was dismissed. Is that correct?
As they say, all contrary. Which means that's not correct.
Okay.
But what has happened there is that, if you'll allow me to explain, the situation is that the county, I believe that the county, with all due respect to the judge, the county and now the judge have gone too far in attempting to allow the county commission not to have to meet with the cities in order to discuss and resolve conflicts, and in particular explain how the cities are going to receive a fair share, the projects within the cities will receive a fair share of the local finance. And as a result of that, the county made a motion to dismiss, and the judge granted that with prejudice, and then basically, what we have is I think the best way to explain it to you is this way. I try to do it simply, but there is that's a procedural, that's the status of the procedure of the case. But as we all know, in the United States and certainly in the state of Florida, all of the rights and powers and privileges are reserved to the individual and to the city as a citizen that are not specifically prohibited by law. And so the statute actually says, if you filed under, says, that's Florida Statutes 86, chapter is a declaratory decree chapter. And it says specifically, all persons whose rights or legal relations are affected by a statute may have determined any question of construction arising under such statute and obtained a declaration of rights or legal relations thereof. And it also goes on, as a purpose of the statute, to say that the circuit courts have jurisdiction to declare rights or legal relations, whether or not further relief is or could be claimed, and the court may declare declaratory judgments of the existence of any power, privilege, or right, or of any fact upon which such power, right, or privilege does or may depend, whether such now exists or will arise in the future. So those are the ones that we're saying that there is the rights preserved for the people, and there's a declaratory judgment act that gives us the right where we have something under statute to interpret it and construe it. And the particular statute that we're construing is 164.105.5, and that particular statute is what we've asked the court to construe. It says, failure to resolve a conflict following authorized procedures as specified in 164.105.3 shall require the scheduling of a joint public meeting between the primary conflicting governmental entities. In this meeting, the governmental bodies of the primary conflicting governmental entities shall consider the state of issues, which was prepared, seek an agreement, and schedule additional meetings. So that's what was done in this process. There was a conference assessment meeting, and the next one was the joint public meeting. And of course, in the course of this, we asked many times for the county commission cordially and then more sternly to come to and have a meeting with the cities to explain, to help address the conflicts, and then possibly explain how they envision the cities receiving a fair share of their particular monies. And of course, we continue to be surprised that the county commission was not where to meet, and they would rather litigate this particular part. But here's the point. The point is that there's a right under statute to be able to file this, and there's nothing in the statute that they said, this is the right under the declaratory decree to get an interpretation of your right under the statute that says what? That says that there is a requirement to attend a joint public meeting under the applicable circumstances of this case. And that's the particular right. Is there anything that prohibits that right in any law? No, there's not. There's not anything in 164.1055 that prohibits somebody from going to the court to get an interpretation of that. Where else would you go to get an interpretation or construction of the applicable law?
Well, I don't know. What's the next step?
We don't know either. And we certainly think that that's the proper
That's process. Probably where we're going next.
Yeah,
I'm going to order the chief of police to arrest them and bring them here.
And that's
okay.
What police was going to
say. So,
you can't go to the gas station or to the Chamber of Commerce and get a construction from them, interpretation of that. That's what the courts are for.
So, Attorney Floyd, I was in a meeting, and I was, besides Mr. Pierce, I was the only one. I was sitting in on the environmental seat because I'm an alternate, because the regular appointment wasn't there, couldn't attend. I was the only one besides Administrator Pierce that really was from the city of Apalachicola. At what point are we going to go ahead, pending working this out, and actually send some representatives from the city of Apalachicola, because there was nobody? I'm troubled by that.
Well, me and the administrator will have a discussion in that.
Okay.
She has a book, and we'll be making a decision soon.
All right. But you understand it's, like,
yes,
at this point, my concerns about
yes,
we're not in the process. Yes. Yeah.
I do
know.
Yeah. Yeah, and, I mean, you know, we have been going forward. We already have had a public hearing on the applications, pre-applications, over 2 months ago. So it's not that the city of Apalachicola, we've been feeding forward more rapidly probably than anybody else in the county.
That kind of segues to my other question, and I don't want to hog the floor, but When will we be able to look at the city's pre-proposals, either online or in the public library, someplace other than, you know, some private place where we can sit down and freeze them?
We will finalize this and have it ready. I'm actually meeting with one of our representatives on Friday to go over the list and see what else, what other ideas we have we want to put on before we actually release the entire list.
Because the county's going to set up a website, and I just think, you know.
We can add that on to an attachment to our website as well.
Okay. Thank you.
Just want to make sure we have everything included that we can.
Carrie, you still have any questions?
Oh, one question. I just, it's something different than this. So I
it's okay.
Did you have
I just said, well, I have one last question for Attorney Floyd. A judge made a ruling, and what effect does that ruling have in terms of what you do next? You went before a judge and a judge made a ruling?
We haven't discussed that yet. I mean, that's what I was bringing together, so I defer to that we counsel before we even decide to respond.
Thank you. I just wanted to say that May 2nd, 3rd, and 4th is the Historic Apalachicola Home and Garden Tour. It's that time of year again. And last year we started adding the symposium, and on Thursday night, May 2nd, we'll have our preservation cocktail party, and you all will be formally invited. The mayor attended last year, as did Betty, and Mayor Commissioner Cook, or City Commissioner, yes, Commissioner Cook, and but you all are invited, and it's going to be at the Orman House. And at that cocktail party, we honor people who have spent their time, their money, their passion on preserving this beautiful town. And then the next day is the symposium. And this year, it's public places, private spaces. And Jody Rosenbaum is our chair and has gotten together people who will conduct panel discussions, and there'll be a garden tour on golf carts given by the Main Street, Historic Main Street has given those to us and procured them. And we'll go around to places like Lafayette Park, but also private gardens like the Willis's Garden, and there'll be tours for them. And then we'll have lunch at Holy Family Center. And we have a wonderful garden example there, which is a roll-up garden that's just been completed. And I just made a great new friend, Ms. Yvonne Tolliver, and learned all about the native plants in Apalachicola. And then I got to talk to Ms. Dot Hill that same day, and then Susan Clemson. So I'm just totally immersed in heirloom plants of Apalachicola. So I'm your new authority. But if you want to have that kind of conversation, garden table, conversations about historic gardens and botanical gardens, and the actual breakout sessions will take place at the Orman Center in the afternoon. So it's going to be a wonderful day. And then, of course, the tour is on Saturday. And you all have complimentary tickets, and we'd love to have you attend. We have 8 beautiful homes and 3 gorgeous gardens. And thank you so much.
Thank you.
Carrie, where is the Orman Center located?
The Orman House.
Okay.
Is that the Orman House? Holy Family Center is where the lunch is, and then we take the golf carts to the Orman House, and that's where the breakout sessions are. And we start at Camellia Hall, so we go all over the town. But we have a website and everything. I don't want to drive you crazy with that, but you all are very supportive. The city is one of our major partners, and as is Main Street and the Chamber of Commerce. And it's a wonderful, synergistic thing. This is our 21st historic tour. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Are there any other?
Yes, sir. I appreciate it. I had the privilege of Commissioner Ash and Danny Webb meeting with the Seafood Festival last week. Concerning the retention pond in the Hendels Park area, and just wondered if they had any more feedback from Federal Rich after our meeting, or had a chance to discuss it any further from our meeting.
Basically, I put them on hold until I had a chance to meet with Water Management District to discuss the idea that I came forward with, see if it'd be acceptable. I'm meeting with them tomorrow at 10 o'clock.
And I also would like to Betty on her idea she came up with during the meeting. She out-thumped the engineers, I'll tell you that.
Betty just looked at it.
Well, can I ask what the purpose of the retention pond was?
I'm sorry?
What's the purpose of the retention pond?
We have several outfalls within town, that stormwater outfall drainage areas. That is actually called the Battery Park outfall. It actually covers about 67 acres of the city where everyone drains to this particular location. The
you
state is
the ball field right here, right?
Well, in the Battery Park ball field vicinity is the way the wording has been presented. But the engineers basically, in their mindset, it had to be this huge retention pond. And so we talked about it briefly, and then I mentioned to ask if a series of buffer tanks or baffle tanks would work. And they say it will, but I want to meet with the Water Management District to make sure it's acceptable by them before we actually pursue that. If we put baffle tanks in the ground, of course, it will not have any impact on anything. It may be a combination of the two, but a smaller pond somewhere. It may not be right in the middle of the ball field. It's just in the vicinity somewhere. But the state is very, very heavy on water quality into the Apalachicola Bay and River. And so that's the reason they're targeting Apalachicola to do some improvements on our water quality. Because right now, our flow goes directly into the water body. And when we have a high tide, that's the reason your water sits in town. When the tide goes down, it flushes out. So we need to have twofold. One is for water quality, one is for retention, so that it will drain off your properties until the tide goes down.
So I mean, does it have to be in that particular area? I mean, it is.
Well, this is the base of the outfall. You wouldn't want to put it up in. It's got to be at the base of the outfall so the water will flow to it and hold it there. But there is the discussion is do a series of baffle tanks along the system, so there may be some of the baffle tanks that's higher up into the outfall, yes. But the bulk of it has to be at the far end of the whole outfall.
All right. Absolutely.
Yes, the Apalachicola Community Garden Group,
if not, just meet.